Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Swing Trading for Dummies, Second Edition, by Omar Bassal, CFA, narrated by Michael Butler Murray. Introduction. Just what is a swing trader? Swing traders hold positions over several days, and sometimes for a few weeks. The goal of swing trading is to profit from short but powerful moves. Swing trading differs from the buy-and-hold approach to investing. Long-term investors may hold a security through periods of weakness lasting weeks, months, or even years, figuring that the tide will eventually turn and their investment thesis will be proven correct. Swing traders don't care for such poor performance in the near term. If a security's price is performing poorly, swing traders exit first and ask questions later. I wish I could tell you that swing trading is fast and easy and leads to overnight profits that will make you an instant millionaire. Perhaps you have seen ads about a quick path to profits by following a proven or secret system. Or maybe you've seen a news story of an elementary school teacher that became a millionaire trading stocks during her lunch break. These ads and stories are alluring. People really want to believe them. But I'm afraid the reality is there are no surefire ways to instant riches. Swing trading is no different. It won't turn you into a millionaire overnight. Period. Anyone who tells you different is either lying, doesn't know, or has something to sell you. As a beginner in swing trading, you'll likely lose money for a period until you master the ropes and apply the information in this book and other resources. I remember reading several books before I started trading, convinced I could begin as an expert. But I lost money for a period, rediscovering lessons found in the very books I read. There are few teachers better than the pain of losing money. As you improve, you can expect to achieve investment performance in line with the overall market, and possibly above it. If you reach an advanced level of swing trading, then you may be able to generate 15 to 20% annually over time. If that number doesn't impress you, it may be because you're underestimating the powerful force of compound returns. A $10,000 investment growing 20% each year will reach more than $383,000 after 20 years. In other words, 38 times your money. One of the most successful investors of all time, Warren Buffett, generated annual returns of about 21% over more than 50 years of investing. About this book. In Swing Trading for Dummies, Second Edition, I introduce you to the strategies and techniques of the swing trader. Moreover, I cover topics given short shrift in some trading textbooks, topics that largely determine your swing trading success. For example, whereas many textbooks focus on chart patterns and technical indicators, this book goes one step further to cover the importance of money management, journal keeping, and strategy planning. Although these subjects are less glamorous than looking at charts, they're actually more important. Because even exceedingly skilled chart readers will fail if they devise a flawed system, take unnecessary risks, and don't learn from their mistakes. Here are some of the subjects this second edition covers. Your trading plan. A trading plan must outline when you're in the market and when you're not. It must detail your criteria for entering and exiting securities. Your plan should also cover what to do when a trade doesn't work out, as well as how much you risk and how you handle your profits. Popular and easy chart patterns to trade. Dozens of chart patterns appear from time to time in securities price patterns, but not all of them are sound or based on investor psychology. That's why I focus on the tried and true chart patterns, to give you the critical ones to look for. Fundamentals. All too often, swing traders pay attention only to the chart and disregard the company behind the chart. You don't need to spend 20 hours a day analyzing a company's financial statements. Swing traders don't have that kind of time on their hands. But it's essential to find out the basics and apply the most important measures in your trading. Investment returns. This is one of those unglamorous topics. but if you don't properly calculate your returns, you'll never know whether you're doing any better than the overall market. The importance of a journal. A journal is like a trading coach, telling you what you did wrong or right in past trades, and helping you to avoid repeating mistakes you made previously. This book shows you the key features of a valuable trading journal. Risk. The most important chapter in this new edition is Chapter 10, where I explain how to manage your portfolio's risk. As remarkable as this may sound, even if you get everything wrong except your risk management, you can still make a profit. Important updates. There have been important changes in the investing environment since the first edition of this book was published in 2008. For example, tax laws have changed, new companies have emerged, old ones have died away, new order types are now available, for example, algorithmic trading, and social media has emerged as a potent force in moving financial markets. Foolish assumptions. I made several assumptions about you when I was writing this book. I'm assuming that you know how to trade securities online, plan on trading stocks or exchange-traded funds, have little or no experience swing trading but are well-versed in the basics of trading in general, are able to access and use websites that cover research, charting, news, and your portfolio account, have the will to change your current trading approach, don't have an MBA, CFA charter, or CMT designation, and need some terms and techniques explained clearly. Icons used in this book. I use icons throughout the book to highlight certain points. Here's what each one means. Remember. Often the remember icon highlights a nuance that may not be apparent at first glance. Warning. I don't use the warning icon often, but when you see it, take heed. I use this icon to point out subject matter that, if ignored, can be hazardous to your financial health. Tip. A tip icon marks advice on making your life easier as a swing trader. The tip icon cuts through the fluff and tells you exactly what you need to know. It also may signal some tidbits that are my own personal insights based on experience. Where to go from here? Like all For Dummies books, this book is modular in format. That means you can skip around to different chapters and focus on what's most relevant to you. Here's my recommendation on how best to use this book depending on your skill level. For a newcomer to swing trading, I strongly encourage you to begin with Part 1 and proceed to Parts 2 and 4. You can skip Part 3 if you plan on exclusively using technical analysis in your swing trading. For the swing trader looking to refine his or her skills, Parts 3 and 4 will likely be of most value to you because you probably already have a good bit of technical analysis under your belt. Help in designing your trading plan, which I cover in Part 4, may be the best way to improve your results. Remember, Chapter 10 is the most important chapter in this book. For the swing trading expert, you may benefit most by using this book to target specific areas for improvement. For additional information you can access on a regular basis, check out the cheat sheet at dummies.com. Part 1. Getting into the swing of things. In this part, figure out how best you can use swing trading, depending on your goals and time commitment. Determine the what you'll swing trade, probably equities, where you'll swing trade, domestically or internationally, when you'll swing trade, during the market or using end-of-day data, and how you'll swing trade. Will you strictly use charts, base your decisions on fundamentals, or a combination of the two? Find out about the rules of the swing trading game so you can produce consistent returns and avoid a loss that wipes out your portfolio. Understand the steps you need to take to set up your trading account, subscribe to the reputable service providers, and keep a trading journal. Discover some recommended strategies for growing your portfolio into a swing trading success story. Chapter 1. Swing Trading from A to Z. In this chapter, contrasting swing trading with other types of trading, deciding how much time you want to devote to swing trading, getting strategic by preparing your trading plan, avoiding the mistakes that many swing traders make. You can earn a living in this world in many different ways. The most common way is by mastering some skill, such as drugs in the case of pharmacists, or coding for web developers, and exchanging your time for money. The more skilled you are, the higher your compensation. The upside of mastering a skill is clear. You're relatively safe with regard to income. Of course, there are no guarantees. Your skill may become outdated. There aren't many horse carriage manufacturers operating today. Or your job may be shipped overseas. You also have a maximum earning potential, given the maximum hours you can work without exhausting yourself. But there's another way to make a living. Swing trading offers you the prospect of earning income based not on the hours you put in, but on the quality of your trades. The better you are at trading, the higher your potential profits. Swing trading takes advantage of short-term price movements and seeks to earn a healthy return on money over a short time period. Remember, swing trading is a good fit for a minority of the population. It involves tremendous amounts of responsibility. You must rely on yourself and can't be reckless or prone to gambling. If you're not disciplined, you may end up with no income, or worse. This chapter is an overview to this book and your guide if you're interested in swing trading. Understanding what swing trading is and isn't. Swing trading is the art and science of profiting from securities' short-term price movements, spanning a few days to a few weeks. Swing traders can be individuals or institutions. They're rarely 100% invested in the market at any time. Rather, they wait for low-risk opportunities and attempt to take the lion's share of a significant move. Generally, large institutional investors, think of a pension plan or a sovereign wealth fund, can't swing trade because their size prohibits them from easily moving into and out of a position. Smaller traders, however, can profit from these short-term movements because their size allows them easier entry and exit from liquid positions. Swing trading is different from day trading or buy-and-hold investing. Those types of investors approach the markets differently, trade at different frequencies, and pay attention to different data sources. You must understand these differences so you don't focus on aspects that are only relevant to long-term investors. Uncle Sam differentiates between trading time frames. What would a discussion of swing trading be without mentioning our good old friend Uncle Sam? He has a say in your profits and losses because you presumably pay taxes. And he treats profits and losses differently depending on whether you're a day or swing trader, or the buy and hold variety. The factor that determines how you're taxed is based on your holding period. If you hold a position for 366 days, 1 year and 1 day, and then sell it, any profits from that position are taxed at a lower rate, called the long-term capital gains tax rate, than your ordinary income tax rate, which can be as high as 37% in 2019. In 2019, the long-term capital gains tax rate ranged between 0% and 20%, depending on the size of the capital gains. However, this rate can change due to tax law changes. Swing traders, of course, are unlikely to qualify for this lower tax rate on positions. Holding periods for swing traders are measured in days, not years. Short-term profits are likely to be taxed at an individual's ordinary income tax rate, called the short-term capital gains tax rate. But there's an exception. The government provides special tax treatment to people it considers pattern day traders. Pattern day traders must trade four or more round-trip day trades in five consecutive business days, and those trades must be more than 6% of your total trading activity during that same five-day period. In other words, those four or more round-trip trades Can't be for small values, just to qualify for the special tax treatment. Pattern day traders must also maintain a brokerage account with at least $25,000 worth of equity, cash and stock. You can read more about the requirements of pattern day traders from the Financial Industry Regulatory Authority's website at finra.org/investors/day-trading-margin-requirements-no-rules. So why is qualifying as a pattern day trader so special? The major benefits are as follows. You can deduct your trading expenses, such as research subscriptions, home office expenses, startup expenses, trading books expenses, on Schedule C of your tax return, which reduces your adjusted gross income. Normally, you would report these expenses on Schedule A, where you can only write off expenses that exceed 2% of your adjusted gross income. You'll be exempt from the wash sale rule. No, this isn't a rule on how you do your laundry. Instead, the IRS doesn't allow most taxpayers to write off a loss on a security if that taxpayer buys back the same security sold for a loss within 30 days. But pattern day traders are exempt from the wash sale rule. Therefore, they can still write off any losses on securities regardless if they buy the same security back within 30 days. You can deduct an unlimited amount of losses from your income. Most taxpayers would treat gains or losses from trading in securities as capital gains and losses. There are limits to how much taxpayers can reduce their taxable income from such losses if they exceed the capital gains. The pattern day trader, however, can treat all gains and losses from security trading as ordinary income and losses. This means if you're having a tough year with significant trading losses and you qualify as a pattern day trader, you can deduct these losses from your income and significantly reduce or eliminate your taxes for that year. A swing trader who trades part-time may have difficulty convincing the IRS that she is a pattern day trader. But if you're a full-time swing trader, you should be able to take advantage of the special treatment of pattern day traders. Otherwise, expect to pay taxes on profits at your ordinary income tax rate, unless you sell securities after holding them for 366 days or longer, which isn't a typical swing trader. However, swing trading in tax-deferred accounts, like in an individual retirement account, IRA, or a 401k plan, takes care of the tax issue. Taxes on gains and profits in such accounts aren't paid until the account holder withdraws the assets, usually at retirement. Because taxes change often and depend on an individual's situation, I strongly recommend consulting an accountant or tax professional to understand how swing trading will affect your taxes. The differences between swing trading and buy-and-hold investing. If you're a buy-and-hold investor in the mold of Warren Buffett, you care little for price swings. Over the long term, equity indexes have tended to rise across countries. Therefore, you prefer to buy quality businesses at discounts to their intrinsic value, also known as their true worth. You pore over financial statements and read the notes to the financial statements. You read through earnings call transcripts, the management presentations given after quarterly earnings results. Short-term price movements are merely opportunities to pick up securities or exit them, at prices not reflective of their true value. In fact, buy-and-hold investors tend to have a portfolio turnover rate, the rate at which their entire portfolio is bought and sold in a year, below 25%, meaning they turn over their portfolio once every 4 years. Buy-and-hold investing is an admirable practice, and many investors should follow this approach. But it's not as time-intensive as swing trading, and not as difficult, in my opinion. But if you have the work ethic, discipline, and interest in swing trading, you can take advantage of its opportunities to achieve the following. Generate an income stream. Buy and hold investors are generally concerned with wealth preservation and growth. They don't invest for current income because they sometimes have to wait a long time for an idea to prove correct. Swing trading, on the other hand, can lead to current income. Time your buys and sells, and hold a basket of positions to diversify your risk. The majority of people aren't interested in closely following their finances and are best served by investing in a basket of domestic and international mutual funds covering stocks, commodities, and other asset classes. Swing traders can hold a few securities across asset classes or sectors and generate higher profits than those who invest passively. Achieve lower drawdowns than buy-and-hold investing. Sometimes markets become overvalued. Just because a market is expensive doesn't mean it will tank. Markets often go from being overvalued to even more overvalued. This inevitably sets the stage for a major market crash. Think 2000 or 2008. During market crashes, buy-and-hold investors can experience drawdowns of 50% or more, meaning a decline in portfolio value from peak to trough. Swing traders, on the other hand, are only in the market when there is opportunity. If the trend is down, swing traders can sit on the sidelines with their cash intact until sunny days return. The differences between swing trading and day trading. Opposite the buy-and-hold investor on the trading continuum is the day trader. Day traders rarely hold positions overnight. Doing so exposes them to the risk of a gap up or down in a security's price the following day that could wipe out a large part of their account. Instead, they monitor price movements on a minute-by-minute basis and time entries and exits that span hours. Day traders have the advantage of riding security price movements that can be quite volatile. This requires time-intensive devotion on their part. Near-term price movements can be driven by a major seller or buyer in the market and not by a company's fundamentals. Hence, day traders concern themselves with investor psychology and news flow more than they do with fundamental data. They're tracking the noise of the market. They want to know whether the noise is getting louder or quieter. But it's not all cake and tea for day traders. They trade so often they rack up major commission charges, which makes it that much more difficult to beat the overall market. A $5,000 profit generated from hundreds of trades may net a day trader a significantly reduced amount after commissions and taxes are taken out. This doesn't include additional costs the day trader must sustain to support his or her activities. Swing traders also face stiff commissions versus the buy-and-hold investor, but nothing as severe as the day trader. Because price movements span several days to several weeks, a company's fundamentals can come into play to a larger degree than they do for the day trader. Day-to-day movements are due less to fundamentals and more to short-term supply and demand of shares. Also, the swing trader can generate higher potential profits on single trades because the holding period is longer than the day trader's holding period. What swing trading is to you, determining your time commitment. Getting started in swing trading requires some reflection. Before you rush out to buy that top-of-the-line laptop or set up that brokerage account, you need to think about what kind of swing trader you want to be. Yes, swing traders come in different shapes and sizes. Your first step is to determine just how much time you can commit to swing trading. You may be a full-time swing trader from your home, in which case you should consider yourself as trading for a living. Or you may be doing this part-time for income with the intention, and hope, of becoming a full-time trader. Many swing traders have full-time jobs and have little time to devote to trading, so they trade primarily to improve the returns of their investment accounts. Or perhaps they're already in retirement and swing trade to grow their assets over time. These swing traders watch the market during the day, but rely on orders placed outside market hours to enter or exit their positions. And if they trade in tax-deferred accounts, like an IRA, they can ignore the tax issue until they begin to withdraw money from their tax-deferred account. Remember, the point is you can swing trade whether you have a full-time job or not, but you need to make adjustments depending on whether you're able to watch the market all day. And by the way, watching the market all day long doesn't necessarily improve your returns. In fact, doing so can lower them if it causes you to overtrade or react to market gyrations. Swing trading as your primary source of income. If you intend to swing trade as your primary means of generating income, be prepared to spend several months, if not years, gaining experience before you're able to give up your job and trade from home full-time. Swing traders who trade full-time devote several hours a day to trading. They research possible trades before, during, and after market hours. And they handle pressure well. Many traders find that they can't handle the stress of trading full-time. After all, if swing trading is your main source of income, you face a lot of pressure to generate consistent profits. And you may be more tempted to gamble if you encounter a string of losses. What many traders fail to realize is that the correct response to a series of losses isn't more trading, but less trading. Take a step back and evaluate the situation. Remember, swing trading for a living isn't difficult in the sense that to excel at it requires some kind of amazing IQ level or insane work ethic. Rather, it requires an incredible amount of self-restraint, discipline, and calm. A swing trader who trades for income must always be unemotional. When things don't work out, he or she doesn't try to get even, but moves on to another opportunity. So don't quit your day job just because you generate impressive profits for a few months. The name of this game is to always have enough capital to come back and trade again. If you plan on living off of $5,000 per month, for example, you can't expect to generate that kind of profit on $30,000 of capital. That would require a monthly gain of 16.67%. Some of the best all-time traders in the world topped out at returns of 20 to 25% annually over 20 to 30 years. Swing trading to supplement income or improve investment returns. This category likely applies to the lion's share of swing traders. Swing trading with an eye on earning additional income or improving the returns on your portfolio is less stressful than swing trading for a living. You still have something to fall back on if you make a mistake, and you can swing trade while holding down a full-time job. Part-time swing traders often do their analysis when they get home from work and then implement trades the following day. Even though they may not be able to watch the market all the time, they can enter stop-loss orders to protect their capital. They really must enter stop-loss orders to avoid the risk of a major decline wiping out a large portion of their capital. If you want to eventually swing trade full-time, you should go through this phase first. Over time, you'll be able to determine how well you've done. And if you follow the other recommendations in this book, like keeping a trading journal, which I cover in Chapter 3, you'll learn from your mistakes and improve your techniques. Swing trading part-time is suitable for those individuals who meet the following criteria. Have a full-time job. Can devote a few hours a week to analyzing markets and securities. Have a passion for financial markets and short-term trading. Have the discipline to consistently place stop-loss orders. Are achieving subpar returns in their current investment portfolios from a financial advisor or third party. Don't gamble with their own money and are unlikely to fall prey to doubling down or taking major risks. If you fit these criteria, then part-time swing trading may be for you. When you first start out, I recommend swing trading with just a small portion of your portfolio, so any early mistakes don't prove too costly. Although paper trading can be beneficial, it can't compare to the emotions you'll be battling as a swing trader when you put your own money on the line. Swing trading just for fun. Some swing traders get a rush from buying and selling securities, sometimes profiting and sometimes losing. Their motivation isn't to provide or supplement current income. Rather, these swing traders do it for the excitement that comes from watching positions they buy and sell move up and down. Of course, this can lead to significant losses if they abandon the rules designed to protect their capital, rules that I outline throughout this book. specifically in Chapter 10. Warning. If you want to swing trade solely for fun, my advice is don't. I recommend that you get your kicks at a bowling alley or basketball court. The danger of trading for fun is that you're using real money with real consequences. You may begin to risk more of your capital to satisfy your need for excitement. If you lose, you may take extreme action to prove yourself right in the end, like putting all your money into one or two securities. By then, you're really in the realm of gambling. If you insist on trading for fun, at least restrict yourself to a small amount of your assets and never touch your retirement nest egg. Remember that you're competing with traders who are motivated by profit, not just excitement. That gives them an advantage over someone who just enjoys the game. Sneaking a peek at the swing trader's strategic plan. Plan your trade and trade your plan. Fail to plan and you plan to fail. Countless cliches address the importance of a trading plan. A trading plan is the business plan of your trading business. Without the plan, you're likely to fall into the trap of making things up as you go. Your trading will be erratic. You won't improve because you won't have the records on your past trading. You may think your trading plan is in your head, but if you haven't written it down, for all intents and purposes, it doesn't exist. Throughout this book, I cover all the important parts of swing trading strategy in detail. In the following sections, I preview the critical parts of the strategy, trimming them all down into one neat little package. For more on your trading plan, see Chapter 10. The what? Determining which securities you'll trade. Many investment securities are in the market. Stocks, also known as public equities, fixed income instruments, funds, open or closed end, options, and futures. This book is geared for swing trading stocks. The following is a description of the three most common instruments I recommend you trade. Public equity, stock. A public equity, or stock, is simply a slice of an ownership of a company with shares traded on an exchange. All companies are either public or private. Private companies can't be easily invested into, whereas public companies can be purchased through a brokerage account. Swing traders often trade stocks exclusively because of the variety, ease, and familiarity of trading corporate stocks. With the internet, you can easily access information on most any publicly traded stock listed in the world. But keep in mind that some countries' financial data may be in the local language and not in English. Most stocks listed in the United States trade every day, but stocks in foreign markets may have less liquidity than U.S.-listed companies, depending on the size of the company and the market. Exchange-traded funds, ETFs. ETFs are pooled investments. The most common ETFs mirror the movement of an index, such as QQQ, a popular ETF that tracks the NASDAQ 100 index, an index of the largest technology and consumer sector companies, or a subsector of an index. If you want to ride a coming tech bounce, you may be better served trading a technology ETF than choosing a particular technology company that may or may not follow the overall tech sector. That's because if you're right on the move, you'll profit from a diversified technology ETF. However, a single technology security may buck the trend. ETFs also offer you the ability to profit from international indexes and commodities. Stocks and ETFs let you gain access to international markets and other asset classes as easily as buying an item on Amazon. For example, you can gain exposure to the commodity gold by trading an ETF with underlying assets in gold bullion, or you can gain access to emerging market stocks, stocks of companies listed in India, Brazil, China, and so on, by buying an ETF listed in the United States. American Depository Receipts, ADRs. ADRs have become increasingly important in today's globalized world. Simply put, an ADR allows U.S. investors to buy shares of foreign companies. ADRs are quoted in U.S. dollars and pay dividends in U.S. dollars. Trading ADRs is much more cost-efficient than setting up accounts in several foreign countries, converting your dollars into foreign currencies, and so on. And because the economic growth of emerging nations is outstripping the growth of developed countries, ADRs can offer strong profit opportunities. ADRs of companies based in emerging markets, like Brazil or China, are sometimes highly leveraged to a particular commodity, making ADRs one way to profit from commodity price strength. I recommend you stick to stocks, ETFs, and ADRs for many reasons. Public equities have the following advantages over the investment vehicles like currencies, fixed income securities, and commodities. Growth. Over long periods of time, public equities or stocks, for example, ownership in a company publicly traded, have generated higher returns than all liquid asset classes. That's because stocks give you the opportunity to own a slice of a company that is engaging in growing its earnings over time. Currencies, commodities, and fixed income securities haven't generated as high returns as public equities over the long term. Liquidity. Liquidity refers to how easily you can convert an asset into cash. For example, if you own shares of Coca-Cola, you could convert those shares into cash in a few seconds. However, it would take weeks, if not months, to convert your home into cash. Stocks tend to be more liquid than other investments, such as fixed income instruments or options. Currencies are more liquid than stocks but offer less upside, meaning they offer lower returns than stocks over the long term. Reasonable downside. Stocks offer competitive returns even without the use of leverage or debt. The most one can lose in any stock is 100%, assuming no leverage. But swing traders are likely to exit after a 5 or 10% decline in shares if the trade goes against them. Other securities can quickly lose value or expire worthless, such as options. Traders of futures contracts, which can be on commodities or stock indexes, can often begin by putting down as little as 2.5% of the value of the contract traded, implying leverage of 40 to 1. A strong move in the wrong direction could easily wipe away 100% of your investment. Many of the other types of securities are illiquid, meaning converting these securities into cash can take longer or be more costly when compared to stocks, and they're not suitable for swing trading or are too risky to reliably trade day to day, such as options. More what? Trading stocks consistent with your values. You may want to restrict the universe of stocks you trade because of your personal or religious beliefs. Socially responsible investing, SRI, refers to investing in companies that have a positive impact on society. For example, you may avoid investment in companies engaged in practices harmful to people. Think companies selling tobacco or alcohol. The environment. Think coal. Or society. Think companies using child labor. For example, some members of the Catholic tradition, as outlined by the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, and the Islamic tradition, referred to as Sharia-compliant investing, use religious-based investing. Both Catholic and Sharia-compliant investment themes include areas such as protecting human life, no abortion, protecting human dignity, prohibiting discrimination, pornography, and so on, and avoiding investment in arms production. Sharia-compliant investors also avoid investing in companies engaging in interest-based activities, banks, which can be used to exploit the poor. Investment restrictions can also be secular in nature. Environmental, social, and governance, ESG, investing has become wildly popular in Europe and is growing in acceptance in the United States and other parts of the world by government and corporate investors. Here is what the ESG considerations represent. The environmental consideration of ESG avoids investing in companies contributing to climate change, whereas promoting investment in companies operating in the clean tech or sustainable energy sectors. The social aspect of ESG investing looks at a company's policies regarding diversity in the workforce and human rights. The governance aspect of ESG investing promotes investment in companies with fair executive and employee compensation policies, as well as independent boards that offer proper oversight of management. If socially responsible investing suits your fancy, you can find more about it at the following websites. For a list of socially responsible ETFs, etf.com/channels/socially-responsible. For ethical screening of stocks, idealratings.com. For the ESG restriction list of the Norwegian Sovereign Wealth Fund, nbim.no/en/responsibility/exclusion-of-companies. The where. Deciding where you'll trade. Where you trade depends a great deal on what you trade. The more trading venues, the wider your investment universe and the more opportunities for profits. The most popular equity trading venues in the United States are the New York Stock Exchange, NYSE, NASDAQ, and NYSE American. These venues list and trade companies based on the United States and abroad. They also list other investment vehicles, such as ETFs, that enable you to profit from movements in prices of commodities and other asset classes. The NASDAQ was the first electronic stock market and has established itself as the home of the largest technology companies in the world, such as Apple, Alphabet, the parent of Google, and Amazon. Not all stocks trade on these markets. Recently, electronic communication networks, ECNs, have emerged as an efficient way to match, buy, and sell orders. ECNs connect individual traders with major brokerage firms. You sometimes can get a better price by submitting orders to an ECN instead of a broker. The easiest way to access ECNs is by subscribing to a broker who provides direct access trading. But swing traders can buy and sell other securities on other markets. For example, many brokers now offer you access to international stocks via London, Hong Kong, Tokyo, Singapore, and so on. These other markets may be more difficult to trade given their trading hours, but they offer a rich set of opportunities. For example, the U.S. equity markets may be in a major decline, for example, whereas Hong Kong stocks are raging higher. Therefore, being able to trade international markets offers you an advantage over the swing trader only focused on U.S. equities. If your broker doesn't offer access to international markets, and you're unwilling to switch your business to one who does, you can also access a limited set of international public equities traded in the United States via ADRs. Refer to the earlier section, The What, determining which securities you'll trade, or ETFs. Remember, if you want to trade commodities, currencies, or other investment vehicles, you need to trade via firms authorized to transact in those markets. I don't recommend you swing trade those securities. The when and the how. Choosing your trading style and strategy. Whether you enter orders during or after market hours affects your entry and exit strategies. Part-time swing traders enter orders when markets are closed and rely on limit and stop losses to execute this strategy. Full-time traders, on the other hand, can execute their entries and exits during the day and incorporate intraday price action into their timing of trades. They also find more trading opportunities because they have more time to devote to swing trading. How you trade refers to your various trading strategies, which I outline in this section. Establishing your analysis techniques. Swing traders rely on two major analysis techniques: technical analysis and fundamental analysis. Technical analysis, broadly speaking, encompasses chart pattern analysis, and the application of mathematical formulas to security prices and volume. Fundamental analysis covers earnings, sales, and other fundamentals of a company or a security. Fundamental analysis also includes the analysis of events or news that may drive a security price higher or lower. For instance, an earnings report, a new CEO, a new product, a government regulation change, and so on. In my experience, most swing traders rely solely, or in large measure, on technical analysis. However, I explain both analysis techniques in this book because I strongly believe that understanding and using both improves the odds of success. Both analysis techniques have their advantages. Technical analysis can be quickly and easily applied to any market or security. For example, a trained swing trader can use technical analysis to quickly decide whether to buy or sell a security using chart patterns of technical indicators. In contrast, a swing trader relying on fundamental analysis needs more time to read about a company, its business, and its earnings before coming to a conclusion, or be more skilled in understanding how an event will impact the shares of a company or the sector. Whether you're trading commodities, currencies, or stocks, you can apply technical analysis uniformly to these markets. In other words, if you know how to interpret a chart, then the kind of security being plotted is largely irrelevant. In my opinion, the ease of application is the biggest advantage technical analysis has over fundamental analysis. Fundamental analysis can answer questions that are beyond the scope of technical analysis, such as, why is this security price moving? Swing trading based in part on the fundamentals is like having a head start in the 100-meter dash. Rallies and declines that are driven by fundamentals are more profitable to trade than rallies and declines that are simply the result of noise in the markets, such as a large mutual fund liquidating or buying a position. Over the long term, security movements are driven by the security's underlying fundamentals. Crude oil prices rise when demand exceeds supply, or when supply becomes scarce. Not, as technical analysis may superficially indicate, because the chart developed a bullish formation. Of course, crude oil, or any security, can rise or fall due to non-fundamental reasons. But such rallies and declines are often fleeting and not as strong as fundamentally driven price moves. Tip: some swing traders shy away from learning about a company's fundamentals. Generally, fundamental analysis is seen as long, laborious, and not always right. But you can improve your swing trading by getting to the essence of a company's fundamentals, even though it does require extensive reading, researching, and understanding of the drivers of an industry. Remember, just how much should you care about a company's fundamentals? The general rule of thumb is that the longer your investment horizon, the more important fundamental analysis becomes. The shorter your horizon, the less important fundamental analysis is in trading securities. This is because short-term movements are driven by momentum, noise, and other factors. Over the long term, however, fundamentals always win out. But just because you understand how to apply fundamentals doesn't mean you'll make money. Markets don't rise simply because they're undervalued, or fall simply because they're overvalued. Markets can remain under or overvalued for long periods of time. That's why I don't recommend swing trading on fundamentals alone. Fundamental analysis tells you which way the wind is blowing, so you're prepared. But technical analysis provides the important timing components. Choosing candidates to buy. You can find promising securities in two main ways: the top-down approach and the bottom-up approach. Both are covered in detail in Chapter 8, but here is a brief rundown. Top-down. Swing traders who prefer the top-down approach identify opportunities beginning at the market level, drill down to the industry level, and finally look at individual companies. If you fit this category, your entry strategy should begin with an examination of the overall markets, then trickle down to the major sectors in the market, and then to the industries within the strongest sectors. At this point, you rank the securities in the industry on some technical or fundamental measure. More on that in Chapter 8. Then you select the securities that meet your entry strategy. Bottom up. Swing traders who use the bottom-up approach are grassroots-oriented individuals who look for strong securities and then filter promising ones by their industry groups or sectors. If you fit this category, your approach begins with a screen of some sort. A screen is a quantitative filter, sometimes depending on whether growth or value stocks are in favor at that particular point in time. If that's the case, you then compare the relative strength of the growth and value indexes, and possibly also the market capitalizations of the market. After identifying which securities rank highest in the screen, you determine which securities meet your entry rules. And then you trade only those securities that reside in leading industry groups. Planning your exit. Most swing traders focus almost entirely on their entry strategy. But it's the exit strategy that determines when you take profits, when you take losses, and when you exit a meandering position so you can put the capital to better use. So, although planning your entry is important, you need to spend equal, if not more, time on your exit. Remember, your exit strategy is most likely going to be technically driven, and it's threefold. Determine when you exit for a profit. Don't take profits based on a gut feeling. Rely on a trigger or catalyst instead. For example, some exit strategies for profits stipulate that the time for departure arrives when prices reach the implied target based on a chart pattern, or when shares close below a moving average. Determine when you exit for a loss. Your exit strategy for losses should be based on the breach of a support level or some type of technical indicator, for example, the 9-day moving average. Support levels are simply price zones where securities stop falling, and resistance levels are price zones where prices stop rising. This keeps your losses limited to some known quantity, barring, of course, a gap down in the security price, which must be addressed by proper position sizing and other risk management techniques. Determine when you exit if a trade generates neither significant profits nor major losses. That is, it meanders sideways and results in dead weight. Some swing traders exit a position quickly if it doesn't perform. I prefer to give a position a few days to prove itself one way or the other. So I recommend exiting a position after 10 days if it hasn't hit your stop-loss level or triggered a profit-taking signal. You should outline your exit strategy by making sure your trading plan addresses when you exit for profit, loss, and capital redeployment. Being in or out of the market. Swing trading is most profitable when a strong uptrend exists and prices are moving higher. However, sometimes the market is weak and trading profits are hard to come by. In such situations, I recommend you exit the market and sit on the sidelines, or turn your attention to a foreign market that is rising consistently. Although some techniques do permit traders to profit from declines in the market, I don't use them, nor do I recommend you do. The risk payoffs aren't favorable, and the costs of such a strategy are higher. Over the long term, stock indexes have risen worldwide, so trading against the long-term trend can prove costly if executed incorrectly. A swing trader can achieve double-digit returns annually without the use of leverage or engaging in trades that profit on the downside. Preparing your risk management plan. The most important part of your trading plan is how you manage risk. Risk management, which I cover in detail in Chapter 10, addresses how you manage risk on an individual security level and on the portfolio level as a whole. A trading plan with a weak entry strategy and a weak exit strategy can still be profitable if the risk management strategy limits losses and lets profits run. In order to effectively manage your risk, you need to account for the following aspects of your trading plan. how much you risk on an individual position. Your trading plan must spell out how much you plan on allocating to a single position. Because I'm unable to predict which of my trades will do exceptionally well and which ones won't, I equally allocate across my positions. Meaning, each security gets the same weight. How much you risk of your overall portfolio. You determine how much of your total portfolio is at risk on a single position. Generally, this figure should be 0.5 to 2%. See Chapter 10. How to achieve proper diversification. Diversification means more than adding several securities. You need to have exposure to different asset classes, sectors, and market capitalizations. When you'll be in the market and when you'll be out. Falling markets can destroy your account value. Therefore, you need specific rules that govern when you'll be in the market, or open to buying stocks, and when you'll be out of the market, and utilizing cash as a safe house. How you implement the 7% rule. How much you risk on a single position is different from how much you risk for your total portfolio. The 7% rule caps your total risk at 7%. Refer to Chapter 10. How you determine your exit points. Your exits should be driven by support and resistance ranges, technical indicators, and profit targets. What triggers an exit? An exit may occur due to a loss, a profit, or a lack of meaningful market action. How you manage your emotions. No matter how effective a risk management system is, a human being, in this case you, ultimately must enact it. Thus, this last point is paramount, because humans are affected by emotions, experiences, and hopes. This fact can cause swing traders to abandon the stringent rules they've developed and make an exception for an existing holding or prospective purchase. Unfortunately, not following trading rules will eventually lead to financial ruin. I found that managing emotions is the most difficult aspect of swing trading. The better you get at trading, the more likely your emotions will convince you to cut corners and abandon the rules that got you to where you are. But emotions can be managed. You can limit their impact by, for example, implementing stop-loss orders that get you out of a security without your interference. The preceding bullets all boil down to two categories of action: position sizing and limiting losses at the portfolio level. So what's the difference between the two? Alexander Elder, a trading expert, once differentiated between losses suffered at the individual stock level and the portfolio level through an analogy of sharks and fish. Specifically, he said that position sizing is done to reduce the risk that your portfolio will suffer a shark bite loss from a single position. That is, a single major loss that wipes out your account value. On the other hand, portfolio risk management is done to prevent several small losses from killing you, or as he described it, death by piranha bites. A single small piranha may not be able to kill a larger mammal, but dozens of piranha working together can be deadly. Similarly, a small loss is not life-threatening for a portfolio. The risk is that several small losses may gang up and cause major loss. That's why you must limit losses on an individual stock level and avoid those shark bites, while also limiting losses on the portfolio level to prevent death by piranha bites. Building your swing trading prowess. Staying on top of your game means you can never stop learning or improving yourself. Sadly, you can't simply become a swing trading extraordinaire and implement your trades with nary a single problem. Heck, a master martial artist doesn't stop after earning his or her black belt. Why would a swing trader? The following action items will help you stay strong throughout your career as a swing trader. Be a student of the markets. Successful swing traders never stop absorbing information. The markets are always changing, with new investment vehicles appearing and new laws being introduced. As a swing trader, you must maintain intellectual curiosity. Reading books is one way to continually stay informed. Take an interest in understanding your positions and reading the pro and con arguments on them. Remember, try to insulate yourself as much as possible from others' opinions, whether the person is an average Joe or a Wall Street analyst. Remember, Wall Street is a community, and analysts send out their opinion reports to thousands, if not millions, of clients, traders, and portfolio managers. Reading those reports can lead you to think like the analyst does, and like countless others do. Good performance doesn't come by copying what everyone else is doing. Read books, weekly magazines, such as The Economist, or studies published in academic journals. Don't read stock reports. They're marketing materials. Admit to losses when they occur. Markets have a way of humbling even the most skilled traders if they let their egos get in the way of their trading. Some traders hold on to losing positions in the hopes that they can eventually break even, a policy that devastates an account in the long run. A losing position not only may lose more money, but it also ties up capital that could be invested in more promising trading opportunities. Don't look for guidance for data from Twitter, Reddit, or message boards. Avoid online community forums where traders and investors talk up or down stocks. Although the idea of sharing notes with others on the internet sounds appealing, the reality is these communities foster groupthink and are inundated with hype and hysteria instead of facts and data-driven research. Form opinions from unbiased sources, like Yahoo Finance or financial statements of stocks you trade, and steer clear of community forums. Chapter 2. Understanding the swing trader's two main strategies. In this chapter, considering different trading strategies and styles. Understanding technical analysis, charts, trends, and indicators. Figuring out fundamental analysis, catalysts, growth stocks, and value stocks. As a soon-to-be swing trader, how do you uncover promising opportunities? And after you uncover those opportunities, how do you time your entries and exits? Very good questions, and I'm glad you asked. Like all traders, swing traders rely primarily on two main strategies. Technical analysis. Technical analysis is the study of price and volume without regard to the fundamentals. Things like profits or sales for a company, or supply and demand in the case of commodities like oil or gold. In other words, technical analysis deals with charting and technical indicators. Traders, those with time frames measured in days or weeks, usually exclusively use technical analysis. They care less about a company's long-term performance than how a stock will perform in the next few weeks. Fundamental analysis. Fundamental analysis focuses on what a company is worth given its assets, what it owns, its cash flows, what it earns, and its liabilities, what it owes. Traders or investors using fundamental analysis want to know if a company is cheap or expensive relative to its peers, the overall market, and growth prospects. They also assess how events, such as new laws, a hit new product, or the opening of a new market, will affect one company or competitors in the industry. Investors, those with time frames measured in years, usually exclusively use fundamental analysis. They're focused on how a company will perform in the coming 3 to 5 years and will tolerate short-term price weakness. So, which strategy should you use? I encourage you to use both strategies. After all, understanding why stocks move and which ones are likely to move can be just as important as knowing which stocks are moving. After spending years trading and managing money, I believe a swing trader should be well-rounded in his or her approach. Strategy and style, the swing trader's bio. In addition to determining whether you'll be a swing trader that uses technical analysis, fundamental analysis, or both, another question to consider is whether you'll be a discretionary swing trader or a systematic one. Some swing traders are discretionary. They use technical and/or fundamental analysis to evaluate each potential trade and make decisions based on the rules they've outlined for themselves. Other swing traders are systematic or quantitative. They use either or both forms of analysis and make trades using an automated system. They rely on a computer to execute their strategies. In the last few years, an important trend has taken hold in the management of institutional assets. For example, pension plan money, sovereign wealth funds, and so on. Whereas in the past, many of these funds invested via discretionary managers, an increasing number is investing via quantitative funds. Think of these funds as computers managing vast amounts of money. Typically, the people running the funds have advanced degrees in mathematics, physics, engineering, and other sciences. They use computer models to study past behavior and then develop models to execute trades based on the historical success of these models. This chapter introduces you to both strategies, technical and fundamental analysis, and both styles of trading, discretionary and quantitative. Only you can determine what kind of trader you want to be based on your interests and expertise. Two forms of analysis, head-to-head. Devoid of calculations, reading, and other time-intensive research, technical analysis allows a swing trader to examine any security, be it stock, commodity, currency, or something else, and make a decision on its likely short or long-term direction, depending on whether the chart being analyzed is a short-term chart, such as a chart where each bar represents an hour or day, or a long-term chart, such as a chart where each bar represents a week or month. Swing traders relying on technical analysis don't care about what a company does, how it makes its money, or whether the CEO graduated at the top or bottom of her class. They care for nothing but the ticker tape, the running list of trades of a security, similar to what you may see on financial news networks at the bottom of the screen. After all, swing traders earn profits based on a security's price, not how many widgets a company sells or the academic pedigree of its board of directors. Remember, technical analysis is particularly important for swing traders with an extremely short time horizon, that is, a couple of days. The shorter your time horizon, the more prominently technical analysis should figure in your trading plan, because short-term price movements are driven by supply and demand for shares and not a company's fundamentals. The swing trader who relies on fundamental analysis is a different breed. This trader wants to know what line of business a company is in, whether that industry is on the rocks or gaining momentum, when a company reports its earnings, and what those earnings expectations are. The swing trader using fundamental analysis isn't interested in every detail of a company's balance sheet. After all, if you're looking at trading stocks of 10 companies in the coming week, you don't have the time to read those companies' annual reports cover to cover. Instead, a high-level overview is enough. Intricate modeling in Excel, though useful, isn't practical for a swing trader who buys and sells stocks over a period of days. Swing traders relying on fundamentals may be categorized as event-driven traders. Event-driven traders wait for specific events and then trade a security based on their expectation of how this event will drive a security's price. For example, assume that Apple unexpectedly announces that the sales of its latest iPhone are above expectations. An event-driven trader might look at which companies will benefit from Apple's success. Perhaps a supplier of Apple products. Or perhaps a major retailer announces disappointing earnings due to competition from e-commerce. An event-driven trader might buy shares of e-commerce companies in anticipation of a strong earnings report that will send their shares higher. Newcomers to swing trading are typically attracted to technical analysis for a couple reasons. Technical analysis, because it relies more on charts and indicators, involves less subjectivity than fundamental analysis. If you put a chart in front of 10 different swing traders, they likely won't differ a lot on the strength or weakness of the chart. However, investors often have wide differences of opinions regarding the value of a company. In technical analysis, there are just two inputs, price and volume. In fundamental analysis, there are dozens. Technical analysis doesn't require nearly as much work as fundamental analysis. A fundamental analyst has more variables to deal with and more calculations to compute. To analyze a firm, a fundamental analyst must understand the dynamics of the firm's industry, its competitors, its cost structure, its management team, and other factors. Except for event-driven trading, decisions based on fundamental analysis take more time to play out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.